my father and mother came from Troy, New York, and Dad went to work for the New York Times back about around 1915. And while he was there in New York, lived up around Riverside Drive, if you know the area. My sister was born right there in Riverside Drive area. I was born across the river in Jersey City, New Jersey. My younger brother was born back in New York again. Dad stayed in New York with the Times for about four more years, and then had an opportunity to go to Providence, Rhode Island, to become the foreman of the press room there at the newspaper. We three kids who were brought up in Rhode Island, first in Providence and later on in Warwick. We went to grammar school and high school there.
Were you the kind of kid that liked school?
No, I don't think so.
No, it didn't appeal to you?
No.
You liked recess more?
Oh, yeah. I like new things. I like to see things. When I come on one of these reunions, I love the bus ride. I see so many new things. And people describe the history that goes along with it. And I think that's great.
Let me ask you a question back in those old days. Did the Depression affect your family?
No. No. You see, Dad was a newspaper man, and the newspapers kept publishing. So not affected like many of his compatriots.
So, you know, when you look back on your childhood, it could be hard times. I mean, you know, the Depression was a difficult time, that kind of thing. But when you look back on your childhood, did you like your childhood?
Oh, yeah.
Why was that?
We lived out of town where we had to do a lot of things for ourselves. We dug our own water well. We took care of our sewage. And Dad was very handy. But he was out so far, he had to do a lot of personal things.
Did you have a lot of fun as a kid?
I think so. I had to go about 5 miles to go to school, and that was kind of hard for us to get to school because we had to hitch rides to get from what few neighbors lived in our area to where we went to school.
And, what kind of stuff would you do in the summers as a kid in that
area? Oh, summers were great. I lived about maybe a block from Narragansett Bay, which is a big bay in the middle of Rhode Island. And we were in that water every day. And we had a big wharf that went out in the bay. And so we could dive and we could do all kinds of things. But swimming was the big activity. During the summertime. Baseball, played a lot of baseball, but nobody played football at that time, so we didn't play football. So I'm going to just settle with swimming and baseball. I graduated from Rhode Island University. My brother was a year behind me. And I went to work for the electric company in Providence. But when Bud came out, he was anxious to go in the Navy. And so I said, if you're going in the Navy, then I'm going to go in the Army, see? So we took off like that, both in the summertime of 1940. So he went off to Navy Flying School. He had licenses too, like I did. And so the Navy took him without question. The Army says you have to be an engineer for a year. So I got stuck with 1 year of engineering. And then I went to flight training.
And you had a college degree at this point?
Oh, yeah.
And what was your college degree in?
Civil engineering.
So they put you in that one-year program?
They were so desperate. Looking back, I can see now what happened. They were able to get a few pilots, but they couldn't get engineers. And so when this guy came along and they saw he had a degree, they said, "You're not going to get away." So they made me serve until I could get more engineers, and then they let me go back to flight training. So I missed a year.
You know, prior to your enlistment, had you ever been in an airplane?
Oh, sure.
Ah, you had.
When I was quite young, my dad took my brother and myself up to the New York State Fair in Syracuse, New York, and don't ask me what year it was, but I was probably about 6 or 7 or 8. And he took us out to this fair where they were giving airplane rides. And I remember my dad lifting the two of us up one at a time, putting us in that open cockpit in the back, strapping us in, and we went for our first ride. We were always, my brother and I were very much air-oriented. We wanted to be pilots.
Well, so you've enlisted. You've gone through that 1 year of training the Army wanted you to go through. Where did it go from there then?
Let's see. When I signed up and went in the Air Force, Air Corps, it was still Air Corps at that time. They sent me out to the West Coast, out to California. And they sent me through flight training on the West Coast. King City was my first Air Force station, flight station. Then Chico, and then Stockton, and I got my wings, the Air Force wings.
Was that a proud day?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. For a couple reasons. I called my girlfriend up, and she agreed to marry me. So I flew back from Stockton, all the way back to Massachusetts, and they had the wedding all set for us, and I was only home a short time, and I had to return to my new bomber training station, which was Roswell, New Mexico. And I felt so proud of my wife, and she had to come all the way across the States in a train. And trains in those days weren't too pleasant. But she came all the way across to this little town of Roswell, and I went out and met her. And I think I had 3 weeks for a honeymoon, which was in New York City. we were not the only ones who were rather desperate for money and food and stuff. There were several West Point cadets who also originally got married, and we had to share rooms, little rooms, and boy, were we glad to get out of there. That took 3 months. Each of the bomber training phases took 3 months. Roswell and that's where we learned to fly the bomber.
Was it when you say the bomber, was it a B-17?
Yeah. Roswell was a B-17 base.
When you initially enlisted, did you expect you were going to end up as a bomber pilot?
Oh, no. I had no way of knowing. And for my size and height, I fully expected I was going to go to fighters, which didn't bother me, but I never had any idea that they would send this little guy off to bomber school, but they did. You couldn't second guess them, so I didn't try.
Do you remember what your initial reaction was to the B-17? That was a big airplane in that era.
It was a big jump from one engine. Oh, no, I had two. Two engines, to four engines, and the big fans were all turning. Very impressive. You felt so powerful. And when they gave those throttles for the forward push, and that bird went down the runway, she lifted off so nice, you were happy. Very happy. After Roswell, after I'm trained, then they sent us all to Salt Lake. And there, the crews were assigned, the individuals. The bombers were from there, and the gunners from there, and navigators from all, were all brought here. And somebody, in their wisdom, decided that these 10 guys, one of each, should form this crew. And 10 of these guys should form this crew. And until they formed about 25 to maybe 35. And now we are not an individual anymore. We're a crew. Act and think like a crew. And they then sent us off to a B-17 base that was devoted to a crew training, which was kind of disastrous for us in that we didn't get a lot of it. We lost an engine. We lost something else. We had two disasters. Crash landed one in Oak City. And so the day that we were supposed to take gunnery training out the side of the airplane at somebody pulling a target, we didn't go. Or we got turned around and had to come back and land because we lost the engine. And then we lost something else, I forget. The landing gear. So I had to land, bring the airplane back and land it on the ground in Oak City. I felt sorry for my crew members because they were looking forward to the day when they can get up there and shoot that gun, but they didn't do it. Our navigator and our bombardier got some training, but not an awful lot. But in summary, I think what I'm saying is that the Air Corps was intent on passing out what training time they had to the pilot. The pilot, they wanted you to get in and get out, but they didn't care how you did it.
What was your sort of command style? I mean, when you were up there in the airplane, you had officers, you had enlisted men. How GI was it? Yes, sir, no, sir.
Oh, no. No, none of that. Absolutely, because we didn't see them. I'm sitting in a chair like this, and I can't see anybody except my co-pilot. And let me add a P.S. here. My co-pilot was one of those people that never had the opportunity to get trained. When he was back in the States and I'm training, he came along later on. They didn't have time for him. So that poor son of a gun, he went overseas with me without a bit of training. And I felt, and he wanted to be a pilot the worst way. But he needed the training and didn't get it. We all went up to pick up our new bomber airplanes, the combat types, up in Grand Island, Nebraska. So we went up there and on the train, but the girls, the wives, were five or six of them, they had to come up on their own because Uncle Sam wouldn't pay for them. He just paid for the guys. We get up there, and the girls checked in at the President Hotel in Grand Island. And they rented this room. They didn't have enough money to do it anymore. They were broke. And we lived at the base, the guys, and went down and saw a new airplane. And we looked it all over, and they said, okay, you'll be leaving for England tomorrow. Well, that night, one of these little tugs that's on the ramp that runs around pulling airplanes ran into the back of my airplane. My wife was so happy, he's got to stay another day. And in fact, they worked on the airplane and they fixed it. And so the next morning we took off, gave my wife $100 and said, I hope you can make it back to Massachusetts. That's all I've got. And we took off early in the morning and flew to Maine.
Describe the journey over to the British Isles. That's okay. A long way
that was
over
eventful.
Water.
The long trip was from Nebraska to Maine, and when I landed there, it was wintertime, and the ramp was glassy slick, and the airplane that came in after me, when I came in to park, he was following me, and the tower gave him instructions to turn the other way, and he tried to turn, and the airplane slid. It slid into the corner of the building, and the nose of the airplane came up inside and killed two of those guys. So they didn't go to England, but then we had parked in the meantime. The next day we took off, and we took off for Goose Bay. It's a little base in Newfoundland. The snow was deep. Snow must have been 8 or 10 feet deep on both sides. You were landing in a like a tunnel or a coffin or something like that. But we got off all right, and the crew didn't mind. So the next morning we took off. And let's see. No, we took off at night. Took off at night and got out of the tunnel and headed out over Greenland. I lost all the radios. So we turned that big bird around. I said, I'm not going to try to hit England without a radio. So we came back and landed in the trench again. And they fixed the radios, and we took off the following night. Up over Greenland, couldn't see it. It was all foggy, but we knew there was snow down there. And I was so proud of my new little navigator. He was a nice kid, and he was very ambitious and energetic. And he navigated us to find that island of Iceland. Out there in that fog, and he did, and I thought he was the greatest thing to happen, because I knew I couldn't find it. But he got us into Ireland, and we stayed there 5 days when the snow closed us in, and we couldn't get off.
So you're 5 days on Iceland?
Yeah, 5 days on Iceland. Finally, they got us off and headed us down for Scotland. I don't know how far it is, 1,000 miles maybe. But on the way down, we got a radio call. Don't go that way. Go this way. The Germans had laid a beam across, an interception beam, across our path to make us believe that our target was over here, our airfield was over here. It wasn't. It was over here. So we went over to Ireland and landed outside of Belfast in a little place called Nuts Corners. And I will always remember that, because that's the worst landing I ever made in my life. And I thought my crew was going to leave me. But they didn't. They stayed with me. And we gave the airplane to a Lockheed activity that was stationed there that was modifying the airplanes. And they put us on a boat across the Irish Sea, over to Liverpool, England, and we went to a personnel center of some kind. I can't recall the details. But from there, we got sent over to Framlingham, the 390th.
When you got to the base at Framlingham with the 390th, did the training continue?
Yes. A different kind of training, but yes, it was very important that you follow the route and you follow the timing and everything that you did, be as strict as you could, because there are other people depending on you to be in a certain place or a certain time, so you tried hard to be good.
Did they emphasize formation flying?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
What did they show you, or what did they teach?
To go back just a little bit, we had, I think, 6 days of local flying. We stayed over England. We didn't go over Germany. We went up and we flew around and checked the neighborhood out, you know, where are the other American fields and where are the British ships and all this stuff. And then several of us would get together and we'd try to fly formation, and it took a little practice, but we got it. After about 5 to 8 or 9 days, the next mission was the one that was loaded. We were loaded with bombs on that one, and we were going to go with the rest of the airplanes. How many airplanes? It varied, but on the average, 12. Six and six, three, all in threes. Three units, three units, three units, six. So that was an average formation, but it did run as high as 24. And now, when I say our formation, I'm talking about our squadron. Now, there's four of us in that group, four squadrons. So now we got one here, and one here, and one here, and one here. Six and six and six and six. One of the first things they told you was, when you make a turn, you don't you stay down here, stay up here. Go around turns like that. Otherwise, you'll slide out and the formation will all break up. So we were very cautious about flying close to get together, and we're all stacked like that. Because if you had to come over the top, you could without hitting another airplane. Anyway, everything was designed to permit you to slip a little bit without hitting somebody else if you did it right.
How many missions did you fly?
31.
And I think you're probably not going to remember every single mission, but were there missions for one reason or another that stood out in your mind?
Oh, yes.
Tell us about some of the missions that stand out.
The first one, obviously. We went into this big Quonset hut in the morning, around 4 o'clock in the morning, to get our briefing for our mission. And there's a big curtain on the board there, and the navigator in charge, he pulled the curtain across, and there's that red line where we're going to go. And it was going to Poland, and the crews that were experienced went, they have never had been that far. I didn't know. It looked normal to me because I hadn't been there. But they were very excited. We got over quite a way, about north of Berlin, still heading for Poland, when all of a sudden a massive cloud deck developed right in front of us, a big one. And we knew we couldn't go over it, but the leader tried to bring us around it, split up the airplanes and bring them around. They came around nose to nose, and it was an awful mess. And oh, there, you know, they couldn't see each other until they got on top of each other. And they broke away, nobody got killed, but they turned around then and went back the other way and then up north to Rostock. Rostock was a coastal German city up near Kiel, if you know what Kiel is. So we went up there and they were waiting for us. Oh boy, that was the first time I was shot at. So they're shooting good shots at us, and they hit, three or four airplanes. I can recall very clearly that one fellow is hit hard, and somebody in another airplane is advising him, go to Sweden, go to Sweden. Sweden was right over there. Now, if he could get to Sweden, they would take care of him, and ultimately, they would fly him back to England. So your chances of surviving were quite good if you could get to Sweden. So although they hit us hard, you know, I got a bunch of holes like everybody else, but the fact that they were able to get to Sweden and get home to England was something that I'll never forget.
What's it like being in a B-17 with flak all around you?
Oh, that's scary. It's scary. You've got these puffs of black smoke, boom, 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 boom. And the thing that's important to know about that flak is that when you're on a bomb run, you cannot vary your course. To give that bombardier a chance to hit the target, you've got to grab a route and hold it. And you've got to be aiming, and you can't vary to avoid the flak or to avoid fighters. Once you get within, I don't know, let's say 10 minutes of the target, you have to hold it. And that took a lot of guts to... But I can remember as soon as we could drop those bombs, you could always hear somebody say, "Let's get the hell out of here," and everybody would try to get away. So the flak was bad. Flak was deadly. And I won't go into how the Germans could figure us out, but they could. They knew what altitude we were at, we knew what course we were at, and after a while they got to know which way we were going to turn, see? And so they could set those shells to go off at that altitude, and it'll fill the whole area. So we knew that. And so it wasn't a very pleasant sight to see them out the window here. We're second mission, we went down towards Switzerland and then turned north to Augsburg. And they started to hit us about halfway to Augsburg, which was about 30, 40 miles away. They started to fire at us. That's when they started to hit Hank, my buddy. And they got these two engines, and he starts falling back. And the rest of us turn for England. And Hank is turning, but he's falling back. Now, the problem with falling back is there are German fighters up there just waiting for you to get by yourself. We bomber guys could defend ourselves pretty well with our guns, but not if we're just one at a time. And Hank was one, and he was coming back, and I would relay to him where I thought he would land. And we figured he was going to land on the English Channel. And he managed to keep going, and he got across that channel and hit the runway right on the other side of the English Channel. He hit that thing and slid in, and they all walked away. The prop fell off the good engine. Fuck across the runway. Hank had more bad luck than he grew over there, I think. I would get hit, but not like he did. Next day, I'd fly the opposite position, and they'd hit him again, or hit him wherever he went. He got hit hard. But he was a nice guy, and he went all through training with me, and we were buddies.
Were there other missions for one reason or another that
Yes.
stood out for you?
The first two are the most important. I went to Berlin three times, and that wasn't a pleasant thought because they had excellent guns, 805s, 75s, 85s, 105s, and 155. And the 155 was so powerful that it could reach the altitude we were flying at. The 105 couldn't. It would explode before it got to us if we got up as high as we could get. So we were scared of those 105s. But Berlin had a massive amount of armament. And another one, I went to one, another mission to Berlin, and I lost a propeller. When I say lost a propeller, I mean it ran away. I couldn't stop it. It's spinning like mad.
Windmilling?
Windmilling fast. And I talked with my co-pilot about it, and we got out the tech order books, and we read them, and we said, okay, let's shut it down then. If it's not doing us any good. It's so flat that it's not biting the air, so it's not pulling. So we shut it down. Now, obviously, I can't stay up with the group. They're going to go off and leave me. And I wasn't too pleased with that, because I knew I'd have to come back across Germany, where there were lots of fighters, and of course France. But there was a cloud deck down around 10,000 feet, and I was able to drop down and fly right on top, heading back to England, and I figured if a German fighter shows up, I'll duck in, which I did. And it just so happened that another cripple I joined him, and we both came back together into the clouds, and so we got home. But that scared me. I didn't think I was going to make it. Man.
Were there missions where your plane actually came under attack by fighters?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, as a matter of fact, we saw that jet, the first jet they came up with. And he was coming straight up and moving. We didn't know how to handle him, but he didn't come near us. Yeah, we had fighters who would come right at us, right straight at our nose, and they put holes in us. But the B-17 was a very allowing airplane. I'm talking technical to you now, but the B-17 had an electrical system. Everything worked by electric. The B-24 worked on hydraulics. So when they got hit, they lost the hydraulics, so they lost the landing gear, they lost the flaps, they lost everything. All the fluid sucked out. We were fortunate. So there were, I'm sure you've seen some of the pictures of the old B-17s that have monstrous holes in the tail where you could drive a car through them. They were electric. And that was the reason why so many of them survived. Not all of them, but some of them did.
What's a fighter look like when it's coming in on you?
I could see that spinner, that colored spinner, the black and white. And anyway, it looked like a spinner. They were hard. Well, I've got to answer that question with a qualification. The pilot couldn't see. He's so busy flying that airplane and staying in formation. He knew that was his function. The gunners were all looking at the fighters or the bombardiers. They can look out and see who's coming. I can't. But I can sure hear it. And that's enough to make your hair stand. When they say, there's a guy at 6 o'clock and he's so many miles out, or a guy at 9 o'clock or whatever, and you'd try to look over there and see if you could see him coming, but you didn't change your route. Your course was the same. But yeah, they'd fire. But of course, our guys are firing too, and the gunners in the other airplanes are all firing at him. But I didn't think the airplanes were great. They had good airplanes. The Focke-Wulf and the Messerschmitt, yeah, both airplanes.
Was anyone on your crew ever injured?
Not bad. Small stuff. And here's Hank getting blasted away, and we're sitting over here fat, dumb, and happy, and it bothered me. Why are we getting away with this, and Hank's getting slapped? But we did.
And that's a good point. I mean, you're seeing other crews shot down.
Oh, yeah.
You're in a constant...
Well, a lot of them.
You know, you're in a war zone, all that. How did you handle the stress of it?
Regardless of what I saw, I didn't get it out of my head that my job is to get that airplane home. And don't you think of anything else but staying in there where you've got all the protection that you need. Don't go goofing off and drifting out of position. Stay there. Let the crew handle all those sideshows. See? You don't have time for that. And that's what brought us home.
I want to make sure I cover it. Anything else unusual about mission? Something stands out in your mind?
Well, I'm telling you about the Fido field. As a matter of fact, I told you about my partner who got shot down and lost a propeller on the ground. That field, actually, at nighttime, would frequently fog in. So the British built an oil pipeline around the field. And when the fog developed, they'd light it. And they'd burn a fire all around that field to disperse the fog so the guys coming in could find the runway. Towards the end of my tour, we had some very unusual but simple missions where we dropped ammunition and food to what we called the Free French, the underground Frenchmen.
The resistance?
Yeah. So we'd get down pretty low. Now that scared me. For a guy that's getting shot at, he likes to be as far away as he can get. Well, we were down on the ground, 500 feet, see? And we could just imagine that those Germans down there could pop us too. But so we didn't. We didn't get shot, but we thought we were. So that was.
How would you know where to drop the supplies?
Pardon me?
How would you know where to drop the supplies? Could you see people on the ground?
The underground passed the word on to us, and we got at the briefing. The target will be, or the little town will be right here, and you drop it on the south side of town. And then, of course, the navigator would find that town for us. And as I say, there were ammunition and food and whatever. But that was my second or third last one.
When you flew your last mission, did you know it was your last mission?
Oh, yeah. Let me explain how that worked. When we first went over there and our loss rate was high, I didn't get shot down, but a lot of guys did. The rate was high. And it was established that you'd have to fly 25 missions before you could go home, before you could stop. Well, I got to 27 or 28, something like that. 25. I was short 4 or 5 anyway. The word came out of 8th Air Force headquarters, the minimum now is 30. So we had to fly beyond the 25, the 30, up. And as we got to 30, don't they raise it again? Now this time I've got 28, and I only need 2 more. But they raise it, and everybody started to complain that they kept jacking up the ante. And so they said, well, those of you that have 28, you fly one more. So I had to fly next to one. I don't remember where it was, but not very disastrous, whatever it was. Then I was eligible to come back to the States. I was sent back to the States to report 1 month after I got back at Atlantic City. That was a replacement depot. And there, they would assign you to some stateside training activity. Only it didn't work in my case. And I was the only one. I got back, and after a month, my wife and I came back to Atlantic City, and we said goodbye there, and and my officers, my four officers, was told to go back. My enlisted men said they were told to stay and go into training jobs. But the four of us went back, and we were very unhappy.
Back to England.
Yeah, because, you know, your probability of getting shot down the second time were getting pretty great. So anyway, I went back, and when I reported into the group, I said, okay, I'm back like you told me. And the guy said, oh, well, we really don't need you. We got a lot of new crews that haven't come in yet. I said, I'll go home then. Oh, no, you won't. So even though it was sad news, it didn't help me to get home. So I stayed around, and I flew missions of new airplanes up to the group, but never over the channel. And then they selected me and a couple other guys to form a C-47 cargo outfit. Do you know what a C-47 is? Okay. So they gave us one airplane, and there were four of us. And we took turns. One guy had flown it before, but we each got a couple of rides and became instructor pilots. All right. But anyway, we could get it off the ground and get it back on. And then we got, about 2 weeks later, we got 30 new airplanes, C-47s, from the States, 90 first pilots, and their function was to fly supplies up to the ground troops over in the Paris area, Paris, north and south of Paris. And so I didn't mind that. That was kind of pleasant. And I frequently, oh no, they assigned us to an air base down in southern England called Grove. And we would usually fly up to one of the big supply depots, and we'd get whatever the ground forces need and load them up and fly them over to the Paris area, dump them out. And I would frequently stop by my old air base. Anybody want to go to Paris? And by God, yeah! And they had trouble convincing some of the commanders they should go, but they did. I'm trying to think of the guy's name was down there just a while ago. He was one of the guys that went over with us. Get on the airplane. Don't need orders. You don't need anything. Just get on. And we'd fly him over to Paris. We'd offload, and we'd come back, and then the next day we'd pick him up. They thought that was fine. I did too. But Eisenhower came up with a policy along about the 1st of December, and I'm on my second tour now, and he said, anybody who is still here after having flown the first tour can go home. So I put a request in. I want to go home. My son is about to be born. So I did. They issued orders, and they sent me back home, and that's the last I saw of World War II.
How long did you stay in the service?
31 years.
And what was your rank when you retired?
Colonel.
You know, when you came back, particularly the first time from the combat experience, were you in any way a different person? Were you different at that point?
I don't think so. I was sent to the B-24 Ford factory at Willow Run, out there by Detroit. And we had so much ego as B-17 guys that we thought the B-17 was the greatest airplane that ever existed, and the B-17 and B-24 was the worst. And yet they're sending me to a B-24 factory to be a test pilot. What a low blow to my ego. But anyway, we managed to survive that, and the war ended.
These days, do you ever think of those war years?
Oh yeah.
I mean, what with all your life experience now, what do you think about now when you reflect?
My
back?
Crew, my crew, yeah. I, you know, there are a couple of them that sure weren't angels, but I'd like to have them around. They were nice guys.